Welcome to one more episode of Web Discovery with IonQure. I'm Sukant Purana, the founder of IonQure. With me is Dr. Tejas Gupte. Tejas is a leading drug discovery expert at IonQure. Hello, Tejas.
Hey. So just to give people a context of this series of drug discovery in IonQure, in the previous episode, we spoke about supplements, the vision that IonQure has about bringing good quality supplements that can really help people, and how supplements can be a very good tool to increase longevity, right? Those were things that we discussed. So Sukant, do you want to go over some of the scientific aspects of how supplements can actually increase longevity?
Yeah, see, supplements or medicine, single compounds, end of the day, they are there to, you know, deal with the same problem. I can tell you what are the major issues in sort of aging research, and it's a very big field. Longevity is a very big field, and people are approaching it with a, you know, focus on some around 200 genes which are associated with longevity, in the sense of where we know there is a clear genetic component. Most of what we can do about longevity depends on our environmental exposure, luck in the sense of what we encounter, whether we get hit by something or not, how many diseases we have. So it's basically environmental exposure and lifestyle. But there is a small factor which is associated with these genes. But in addition to these genes, in addition to the genomics and genetics of this, people are looking at even a lot of about genetic material organization, whether it's telomere or whether it's genetic material in general, its packing, its regulation, its loss also. For example, there is very interesting work in terms of how much DNA does a dog lose from its cardiac muscle cells versus humans lose. And it comes out to be the same fraction that they're losing 6 times faster. So, you know, the standard dog year versus human year comparison even matches the DNA loss. So there is a lot of things about DNA loss and genomic stability that seems to be a very important factor, somatic thing. But then in addition to that, specifically telomeres, there are epigenetic factors that people have started to look at. What is happening with DNA methylation? So in case of methylation, as you know, with some of the classic and astounding experiments, people have been able to increase lifespan in double digit percentage by sort of reverting the methylation status to which is more akin to young age. So they take an elderly, it's mammalian work, so it's not some interesting stuff done in flies. The other important thing is associated with a lot of intracellular signaling, which is tied to actually sort of fasting, and essentially comes down to metabolic pathways such as FOXO3, you know, sirtuin pathway, or you're looking at growth hormone or insulin like growth factor, right? And then essentially this also starvation contributes to electron transport chain also. So how much energetic is there? So starvation, intermittent starvation, intermittent fasting seems to be increasing lifespan in invertebrates for sure. The monkey results have been not as convincing. Some studies have shown that it does, and some show that it does not. But one of the things which has been constant is that whether it's a small mammal, large mammal, or an invertebrate, intermittent fasting definitely improves other parameters of health. So even if the animal is not living longer, it is improving. And some of the genes which are overlapping with fasting, I'll tell you from a classic, one of the last papers of Seymour Benzer, one of the greats in Drosophila field. So what had happened is, in case of Benzer, he was a big advocate of sodium butyrate. So Benzer also, I would say, like one of his inspiration, Linus Pauling, got hung up on some molecule. Who got hung up on vitamin C. Yeah. But Seymour Benzer advocated sodium butyrate. But what it turned out is sodium butyrate is having a huge overlap with the same genes which are epigenetically altered, as are altered with exercise. So one is an excise factor and somewhat a decent overlap with the starvation related genes.
Okay.
So, and all seem to be affecting longevity. So there are, you know, sort of some reset buttons. They may not make it such that we can entirely reset things. So that is one important factor in terms of that. Then in addition to all these, you know, there is a whole idea of how differentiated cells are.
Mm-hmm.
Some cells can become less differentiated, like in diabetes. Islets of Langerhans can de-differentiate rather than be lost. They're de-differentiated. So there was this huge uproar about Yamanaka factors.
Mm-hmm.
And then obviously the list of things which are involved in differentiating stem cells has increased. The understanding has improved. In fact, one of the minor things with Iron Cure is we have done some work on differentiation of neurons in case of Parkinson's.
Okay.
That is honestly at a very early stage, but it's very interesting lead.
Mm-hmm.
So if you can get the neurons to be sort of more functional back. But stem cell, having more stem cells, and in some cases having less differentiated cells, and in some parts of the body having more differentiated cells,
mm-hmm.
is important factor in reducing anti-aging or increasing longevity. But it can't be a sledgehammer on it.
Correct. So I think what you're saying is that it has to be a very smart approach. It's not a one size fits all. So there are some tissues in which you want more programmed cell death to clear up, you know, cells which are not functioning as well. And in some places you want to rather reprogram the cells to bring them to a younger fate, not necessarily stake them all the way back to being a stem cell, but just behave as a slightly younger cell. And I think one of the points that starvation also brings up is oxidative damage, right? Because the more mitochondrial transport chains are involved, we know mitochondria are the primary sites of generation of reactive oxygen species. And if and cells can deal with a certain amount of ROS in a healthy manner, but if it exceeds that, then the excess reactive oxygen species can actually cause damage to the proteins, right? So what you by starvation, if you're cutting down on how much nutrients flow through the mitochondria, then you're actually reducing temporarily at least the oxidative damage. Also, starvation is one of the ways in which you can induce autophagy. And autophagy actually gives the cell a chance to slightly reboot, clean up, you know, accumulated or accumulated non-functional proteins in some sense, which takes slightly longer. But that also brings me to other things like proteostasis. Do you want to tell people about that?
Yeah.
As proteostasis, how it changes with age?
Absolutely. So it's not just that, you know, so there is things related to initially to DNA.
Mm-hmm.
So we discussed that.
Right.
And there are aspects even of transcription and translation machinery. But then you have things related to proper protein folding.
Right.
Then you have aspects related to not just protein folding, protein degradation. So if the protein in the cell is not doing its job and you don't have the proper ubiquitin tags on it, and the protein is not reaching lysosome on time.
Right.
And then there's one aspect which our people haven't really looked at much, and we at Iron Cure are extremely interested in, is in case of neurodegeneration, are you having protein mistrafficking?
Right.
So it's not about that. So a mistrafficking and creating obstacles within the cell. So there are other aspects also. So anti-aging in general is working with hormonal changes. So if you're looking at menopause in women, it's associated with hormonal changes.
Correct.
Men also go through a more slow menopause in slow motion. They don't like to acknowledge it, but testosterone levels do go down.
Sure.
There is an old dictum which is clearly wrong, that men and horse never get old, they just die. That's not correct. Men get old first, and you know, they pretend to be macho for much longer than they actually are.
Right.
But but then there are other factors associated with aging, where we understand some mechanisms, not all, which are related to sleep. We know sleep may be even tied to things which we have sort of discussed, is intracellular waste aggregation, or even waste aggregation outside the cell. You know, you get lipofuscin aggregates, where a lot of old cells fuse with each other, and they stay in tissue. So even if you look at old people's skin, right, we are getting there, at least I'm getting there. I'm not entirely there yet. So you can start seeing those patches on skin. So they are indication of liposarcoma skin thing. So there are, you know, variety of other interesting things too with anti-aging, which are related to smart way of antioxidant signaling. So we discussed metabolome. So metabolomic changes, we discussed DNA, we discussed protein, we discussed cell, we discussed clearing up the cells. So, or, you know, programs like that. But one of the aspects is oxidative stress that is also there. So there are several of these aspects. So supplements, one last important point that I'd like to say, supplements might work on a lot of these, but what is the difference between single molecule and supplements is in most of the times we know the answer what a supplement does from a phenotype, not from mechanism point of view.
Right.
So we know that this is good for healthy living, this is good for immune modulation, or this is, you know, good for getting sleep, but we don't know how. So most of the time supplements we don't know. So that's the difference between supplements where we stand as a whole scientific community versus where we stand with single molecules. There is more mechanistic understanding with single molecules.
Right, right. I think that answer sort of covers a lot of the mechanisms that you can target for aging. So I think I'll ask you a more specific question now. At Iron Cure, how are we moving forward with anti-aging and longevity supplements or treatments, or, you know, any kind of help in that manner?
So I will, if you allow me, I'll change the question not to supplements. We're doing both supplements and small molecules.
Okay.
So we are targeting a lot of things, but let me tell you first thing where we have maximum number of leads. That is related to energy metabolism.
Okay.
We have over 40 new single molecule leads, which are targeting electron transport chain. And they have, it's not just computational work. In a lot of cases, our work is initially computational, but here we have a decent amount of in vitro data, and in some cases, animal data, of the, how they are proving to be useful in various neurodegenerative diseases.
Okay.
Most of our focus on Parkinson's, but we have also done some Alzheimer's work. So how targeting energy metabolism can revert an animal state to more young-like state. And obviously, it remains to be proven whether it can work in humans or not. We have also done something similar with some supplements, which can do the same, but the amount of supplements doing the same is bit better. At least in our test, what we have gone through. Then we are looking at inflammation and immune system, because with age, inflammation increases, immune system gets altered. So that is something which you are aware of, that we have been looking at a massive number of plants. We are systematizing data of every single plant that has ever been published. And in addition to that, we have some secrets up our sleeves, because we have conducted around slightly less than 30 surveys. So we have a lot of plant knowledge which is not there available to the world. So we intend to find more molecules out of those and hopefully take Iron Cure to a very high success. So that is another aspect which is related to inflammation and immune system modulation.
Right.
And then there is another aspect of anti-aging which is related to reducing fibrosis. So fibrosis is a very common thing which happens with age. So liver, kidney, all these organs stop functioning well. There is enough fibrosis with age, with infection. It's almost like war wounds, right? Think of a human body constantly fighting infection and you're getting war wounds.
Absolutely.
And you want to make sure that you can clear those wounds and revive to more normal state. So that is another aspect which we are looking at.
Okay.
Then we have something. I don't want to get people's hopes high. I'm somebody who's usually very high advertisement. We have, it's a very preliminary finding. We have some active ingredients from plants which are turning out to be slightly better than rapamycin, as well as metformin, in some of the anti-aging effects. If it is there, I think those molecules alone can take Iron Cure to $1 billion plus company.
Right.
Forget everything else that we are doing. So that is some aspect of anti-aging that Iron Cure is working at. In addition to these things which are related to inflammation, metabolism. We have some other interesting things related to stem cell differentiation,
okay.
or much more preliminary stage.
Mm-hmm.
Then there is some interesting computational work on epigenetics.
Mm-hmm.
That said, we have just started scratching the surface of anti-aging.
Right.
Our main push has been from mechanistic angle is going to be whatever I just told you, targeting energy metabolism,
sure.
targeting inflammation,
yeah.
and working with some of our leads which can be competitive with metformin and rapamycin. But that is the mechanism angle. But in addition to mechanism,
mm-hmm.
Since we are cataloging every bit of plant information that is out there,
mm-hmm.
and not just as medicine, even as food, right?
Right.
When you're coming to plant food and medicine is a continuum. So we want to actually provide this and find the active things out of various food, increase the quality of such food. So for mechanism, if we ignore the mechanism, if we just go by the traditional knowledge,
mm-hmm.
we do have quite a bit of knowledge. And I do not want to sound bombastic. I know this is what sells these days. It makes people top politicians or music star. But I do think that we fundamentally might have, if not the best, we have one of the best internal data on plants, globally speaking.
Right.
So we'll see, because I don't want to make a claim that we have the best and one day I find out that we have some competitor who are having some secrets of their field. So I don't really know about what all my competitors are up to, but we are definitely doing up there at the very top.
Sure.
And from multiple angle, we would like to provide a lot of these plants in form of well-tested supplements. We do not believe in putting out anything without proper due testing. We
mm-hmm.
want to do testing for a supplement in as much depth as we will do for a single molecule and then mm-hmm. put it out. But we do have quite a lot of things in anti-aging. And for me, neurodegeneration, which is a component of anti-aging,
mm-hmm.
Has been one of the biggest passion projects. In fact, this is how one, in some ways, Iron Cure started.
Right. As the name would suggest, right? It's about ions flowing in. So electrophysiology has been your training ground, has been your passion in some sense, and therefore neurodegeneration makes absolute sense. But I want to come back to like one word that you use, a billion-dollar company, and I'm going to ask you to shed some light on how we have moved from being a computation-heavy company in the beginning to what our efforts now are in terms of how do we perceive moving forward, right? So computation is of course where we have started, but that's not all that we intend to continue doing. We have already started on some other paths. So do you want to illuminate the path for our viewers and way forward?
Absolutely. So we have taken a very unusual journey.
Mm-hmm.
The company started putting in what most people may say is a gamble, and I'm sure it's panning out. Most people would have considered it stupid when I started. I just put in everything I had. So we have received government funding, and we are applying for registering Iron Cure in various countries, and we will be applying for government funding. But we have fundamentally not gone to any VC so far.
Mm-hmm.
So imagine people would laugh at the idea of trying to build a startup by bootstrapping it. But that's what I've been doing so far. My long-term agenda is not to ever go public, because I don't want to be beholden to mm-hmm. profits.
Right.
So I would take some strategic investment in small amount, but Iron Cure fundamentally will be a drug discovery, drug development, and a manufacturing company,
mm-hmm.
which will be making medicines and supplements. And I'm willing to go for the long slog of doing it so that we can put services ahead of the profits. Obviously, as a company, we will be making profits, but we want to put services. Our job is to serve humanity. So that has been the path. And right now, what we are looking at, we have some wonderful leads, which we will discuss in subsequent episodes on epilepsy. We have several leads on SARS-CoV-2.
Mm-hmm.
Really, I mean, this is the time we can help. I mean, we really want to help the world.
Right.
In SARS-CoV-2. We have a lot of leads in neurodegeneration.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of that, for example, you, who we were trained in US, I consider US to be my first home, even though I was born in India. I spent most of my adult life and best years of my life in the US. So more of a, I mean, in India, I've been a misfit. I'm a result of, culturally a result more of American system than Indian system. But we have all been, a lot of us have been in India. Some members of INQ are based in Austin, Texas. Some of them are based in San Francisco Bay Area. There are a few members even in Toronto and Canada. But INQ right now, as it stands, with a lot of major bulk chunk of scientists are based in India, giving citizen science globally. But to do this wet work, it is going to be impossible if you put more of our eggs in this basket of doing experimental work in India.
Right.
So the next immediate next step for IonCure over the next 3 to 4 months is to set up facilities in the US. If needed, also Canada. Right. The goal is to sort of move to North America and make the base there. Use India. India has amazing resources. It has its so use other places where we have bases, like India, Pakistan, other countries where we have lots of citizen scientists, where we have, and in India we have a decent establishment. Use these for what their strengths are, but move to North America. That is first point agenda. Second, secure funding to set up bed facility.
Right.
Third is to release supplements, because they can go to market fast and return, get us return on investment.
Sure.
But we really want to test neurodegeneration leads. We really want to test the SARS-CoV-2 leads, because if we can, forget whether we are $1 billion or we just make $1 million, if we can help make this pandemic get over sooner, we would think, I'm sure you and I would feel that our lives serve a purpose, right?
Absolutely.
We made a difference to the market.
Yeah. And purpose is very important, and we have elaborated our mission just to reiterate. It's putting people and putting service before profits. And on that note, I think, thank you, Sukant, for propounding on the various scientific aspects of anti-aging, telling our viewers about how IonCure plans to go about achieving this, and also giving them an idea of what the future holds for IonCure, right? So, thank you so much.
Thank you, Tejas. And I would urge our viewers to go to our website, www.ioncurerx.com, IonCureRx.com. And please get in touch with us. We are always open to citizens. Thank you so much for that. Bye-bye.